Welcome to this GSK Human Performance Lab webinar. The GSK Human Performance Lab is a world-class science and research facility aimed to deliver innovation and science across six key pillars: strength, stamina, cognition, hydration, metabolism, and recovery. Welcome to the second of our ongoing applied performance seminars. My name is Brad Sanderson, and I'm joined today by a fantastic cast of experts who will help me unpick the intricacies of ultra-endurance performance. So, on the panel today, we have Shusannah Pillinger, who recently took part in the ultra-endurance cycle event, Race Across America. Welcome, Shu. We also have two individuals who were pivotal in Shu's campaign. We've got Erica Lee, who provided chief medical support during the event, and we've got Matt Furber from our team here at the GSK Human Performance Lab, who provided nutrition and physiology support. And alongside them, we've got Barry O'Neill, who's our cognitive lead here at the GSK Human Performance Lab, and who'll provide cognitive insight into ultra-endurance performance. So welcome all. So Shu, if I can start with you, again, what we want to try and do is get a sense of the immense scale of Race Across America. And we know we're talking about an event where cyclists travel over 3,000 miles, which is a distance almost 30% greater than the Tour de France. But can you just provide a bit more detail into exactly what are the key challenges and just really give us a sense of the immense scale again?
Okay, well, you're right. Race Across America is over 3,000 miles. It's a transcontinental cycle race. The clock starts on the west coast in Oceanside, California, and it doesn't stop until the east coast in Annapolis, Maryland. This year, there were about 48 solos, including six solo women riding. The idea is to reach the finish within a cutoff time to be an official finisher, for which, for women, that's for 12 days and 21 hours. The terrain and climate is varied across the continent, so you've got a number of challenges to deal with, not just the immense cycling challenge itself. We've got the desert, the Mojave Desert, which can reach temperatures up to 45 degrees. You've got the Rocky Mountain Range, which you could, you're exposed to extreme altitude, so that you have to actually go over Wolf Creek Pass, which is at an altitude of 3,300 meters, which is higher than any paved road in Europe. So much higher than they go in the Tour de France.
Right.
Then you've got the high plains across Kansas and Missouri, which you have to pass through Tornado Alley. It's notorious for its crosswinds and high temperatures. And then on the east side, you've got yet another mountain range, the Appalachians, which, although slightly different climbing, it's not long, low passes, long passes. It's kind of choppy, short, sharp hills to climb, but much more climbing than going over the Rocky Mountains. So there's a lot of challenges there.
I bet. So some key environmental and physical challenges throughout. So I guess the next question is, why on earth? Why on earth would you take on such an epic challenge?
Well, I didn't actually decide to take on this challenge. I kind of fell into it by accident. I'd been doing triathlons a number of years, since about 2006, and I'd started with a sprint triathlon. I'd built up to Olympic, half Ironman, Ironman. Last year, did a double Ironman and became the national champion here in Britain. During my training for Ironman, I was doing progressively longer cycle rides, and cycling is my favorite aspect of triathlon. And I'd entered a 24-hour time trial. I ticked a box on the form as I entered to do it as a RAAM qualifier. And I ended up coming first woman, third overall, and in the process qualifying for this Race Across America. It was only when I started digging into it more that I discovered no British woman had ever completed it within the time limit. And so that became a little bit of a focus.
Okay. And Matt, if I can jump across to you, can you just tell us a little bit about how the GSK Human Performance Lab became involved in Shu's campaign, and what was the type of support that was provided?
Well, after we first made initial contact with Shu and had a discussion about what an amazing challenge it was, You know, for us at the GSK Human Performance Lab, we're looking to break the boundaries of human performance. And you know, is there a tougher challenge in the world than Race Across America? So you know, some would say it is the toughest endurance challenge out there. So for us to get a real great further insight into how an athlete responds during that type of challenge was really good. But also for us, it was to further the knowledge and further the research within the area. So a real key discussion that we had with Shu beforehand was not only did we want to provide nutrition support, but Shu was really keen to have some research done on her so that she can then inform others who are going to maybe take on a challenge after. Because as I said, there's literally nothing on or very minimal amount of understanding on such an ultra endurance challenge.
Okay.
So for us at the HPL, it was an ideal opportunity to get involved in such an amazing opportunity.
So you mentioned a few things there, but specific support, yeah. Nutrition, physiology, what else was involved?
So after sitting down with Shu and having a bit of a needs analysis, looking at where the literature was out there and also looking at understanding more about the event, we kind of put a performance package together to support her. So that included various carbohydrate oxidation tests, physiological tests, how she responds in the heat, and also looking at things like core temperature response as well. And within that, we built in a research protocol. So the research included things like her hormonal sleep patterns. And within that, we kind of had a really nice performance package. But a real key aspect of that was looking at the cognition side of things as well.
That's a nice segue to come across to Barry and talk about cognition. And Barry, in terms of cognitive or brain related aspects of ultra endurance performance, can you give us some insight there?
Sure, Brad. At the GSK Human Performance Lab, one of our core pillars is cognition. So we're interested in the brain's role in elite performance. And this Race Across America and Shu's participation in that gave us a really insightful and useful, I suppose, an extreme way to look at the brain's role in performance, but also not just the brain's control of, say, pacing, strategy, and its role in fatigue, but more so the fundamental cognitive processes such as attention, memory, those kind of things, and how they are affected by environmental stressors. And I guess she was already touched on some of the different environments, the physical output that she was going to endure during the race. So for us, it's a key activity, I suppose, to help us look at the role of these stressors on fundamental cognitive processing, and then the knock-on effect on performance. Okay. So to allow us to gain some insights into how we can minimize the impact of these events on fundamental cognitive processing and thereby performance. Because with an event of this type, it is about minimizing the impact in order to help the person perform the best they can to get to the end.
Great insight, and obviously Shu's campaign provided a great model for looking at cognition.
Yep.
Great. Matt, I'll jump back to you again, and you touched on nutrition planning, and obviously when we're talking about the Race Across America event, we know that cyclists aim to stay on the bike for 22 hours a day in normal scenarios, and this obviously takes an enormous amount of fuel. Yeah. So what was the fueling strategy, and how did you actually develop that?
So doing a few calculations, we worked out that Shu would be needing up to around about 9,000 to 10,000 calories per day just to fuel her through the 22 hours of riding. So with that, such a vast amount of calorific intake, it was important to optimise every second of every day to make sure that we're getting the amount of carbohydrate and the amount of energy into her system. So with that, if she's riding for 22 hours a day, basically we need to make sure that we're feeding her while she's on the bike. Ideally, at rest, you'd have nice big meals, because then you've got much greater blood flow to the gut. There's a vascular shunt when you exercise, so it restricts the blood flow to your gut, which slows down the rate of emptying, basically. So it's important to understand what Shu's individual tolerance is in terms of carbohydrate to optimise the amount that she can utilise. Guidelines suggest somewhere between 30 to 60 grams of glucose. Maybe if you have a mixed carbohydrate, you can push it up to 90. But just by doing guidelines, you may actually cause too much carbohydrate and cause GI distress, or not enough, and over such a long duration you actually cause progressive energy loss. So it's important that we understood her individual tolerance. So we did a couple of tests. The first test we did was exogenous carbohydrate oxidation, where basically we plied Shu with an awful lot of carbohydrate from a drink, and then we got her to ride for 4 hours in the lab, and we were taking expired air, and from there we can actually look at the amount of carbohydrate she was using from an external source, and that actually turned out to be 93 grams.
Okay.
So we knew the amount of carbohydrate that she could take every hour. On top of that, we did a couple of other tests. So one of them was in our enviro chamber, where we looked at her sweat response, so her fluid loss and also her electrolyte balance and sodium loss, to look at what it was in the heat. But we also replicated that in acclimate conditions as well. So that gave us an idea of, you know, at night when it was cooler or in the heat of the day, her sweat loss. Also, on top of that as well, we developed a bespoke drink. So what we know in these endurance challenges is a huge thing, which we'll actually touch on later in the webinar, is palate fatigue, which is basically, you know, the fact that you just kind of get, you just can't consume that food anymore. So it's important that the drink that we provided and made for Shu actually she liked. So we had, what were the two flavours? It was blackcurrant
and
pink grapefruit. So her two favourite flavours, basically. So we developed two drinks. The drinks matched her energy demands, matched her sweat loss, but they also, one of them contained caffeine as well because of the sleep demand as well on top of that.
And Shu, what was it like going into the event with that sort of insight?
This was great for me. I'd done numerous races in the build-up for this, and one in particular, race around Ireland, I did in September, where pretty much anything that could have gone wrong went wrong.
Okay.
And I was able to bring quite a lot of information to our discussions with Matt, particularly, about what had actually happened and what I needed to improve on. Nutrition, particularly, one of them. Sleep strategy, another. So actually being able to have that information to hand that we could actually use and learn from is phenomenal.
No, that's great. And I guess on the flip side, I'm going to jump slightly here. We've talked a lot about the time on the bike, and that gives almost no time for rest. And we know that sleep deprivation is a major concern during the race across America. Barry, I guess I'm just jumping to you firstly. Could you just give us some insight into sleep deprivation and how it affects athletes, particularly ultra endurance?
Sleep is very important, Brad. That goes without saying. I mean, it's something that we spend a third of our life doing. So from an evolutionary perspective, I mean, we wouldn't keep doing it if it didn't have some use. I think on that we can agree. I think where the literature is a bit more mixed is on the exact effects of sleep deprivation versus sleep restriction. So what we're calling here sleep deprivation will be a sustained period of wakefulness. So that is not exactly what's happening in the race across America. It's actually sleep restriction where, as you mentioned, you're trying to maximize your amount of time on the bike, so you've only got a small period to rest. So essentially, that has quite a high biological cost on the system, so peripherally and centrally. So you get a lot of things happening in the brain, mostly around glucose utilization and how your brain uses that, and then around information processing, which can contribute to the hallucinations and illusions and stuff like that. But then you also get the performance decrements. So with consistent sleep deprivation, you build up a sleep debt, so your performance essentially decreases. And even with, as you can attest to, when the race is over, you've built up this sleep debt, which is hard to get back to normal functioning. So, I mean, to say that sleep deprivation, or in this case, sleep restriction, is a key factor for the race, it's an understatement. It's a very important factor, along with a lot of the other things that we'll touch on later.
And Shu, we'll touch on how you're affected a little bit later, but thinking about how important sleep deprivation is, or sleep, you referred to it as sleep restriction, was there anything you could do in advance? Was there a way to train for that challenge?
Well, I have to say, going into Race Across America, it was my biggest worry. It was the reason I didn't finish Race Around Ireland. That was a 5.5-day race where day 3 to 4, I started to experience quite vivid hallucinations. And they were actually quite nasty, aggressive illusions of goblins jumping out at me from hedges. So I'd gone into this knowing that there was no way I wanted to experience that again. So I set about trying to work out whether there were ways I could train for this. It's difficult to train for because you don't tend to see these effects until a long time into the race. So that was 3-4 days. It's difficult to do training where you're putting yourself in that situation for long periods of time, particularly if you work and have to fit in your training around everything, and you're expecting volunteers to come and crew for you on events. But I did a number of things where I would try and train at night, go out when I was tired, go out again after a little bit of sleep to see whether I could get the goblins to reappear so that I could try and work out how I'd handle it if I saw that again.
Yeah.
We also realised that given the timing of not being able to replicate this effectively, we had to come up with a sleep strategy that was the best given the knowledge we had. So one of the things we did was a sleep study where I did some training out in Mallorca, and I was wearing an actigraph that monitored all my my sleep patterns.
That provided us some useful data before she went on the race to give us a look at her sleep efficiency across a typical night's sleep.
Okay.
And I mean, we tried to use that data within the constraints of the race across America, because again, you've touched on it, that we're trying to maximize the amount of time on the bike. So what we saw in her sleep patterns in Mallorca, where she was doing a fair bit of output during the day and training and cycling a lot, was that the first 4 hours were probably the most fruitful as regards sleep efficiency. Within that 4 hours, the first three tended to be the most efficient. And again, within that, the first hour, that first 20 minutes was again the most efficient of that first hour. So it gave us some indications for Matt and Erica and the crew how to structure the breaks that she would have. And when was best to maximize the time to give her either a 20-minute break, where we knew that she was efficient within that first hour of the 20 minutes of the first hour, versus giving her a longer break and then getting back on the bike and getting running again.
Thank you both. Erica, if I can come to you, thank you for sitting so patiently. We've talked about nutrition, we've talked about cognition, and we've talked about physiology support. Can you give us some insight into, the enormous task that was the medical planning and the medical scenario planning that went into Shu's Race Across America campaign?
I think we've touched on the magnitude of what RAAM is, really, but, you know, just to brief it up, it's a continuous, low-intensity, interspersed with high-intensity bouts. And when you combine that with the environmental conditions that we experienced in America, you bring a subset of conditions that you expect from a medical perspective. A lot of my role initially, pre-event, was about planning, making sure that everyone was safe, as in fit and healthy to go on the trip, making sure that Shu and I had a discussion about whether there were any concerns medically from her perspective, whether there were going to be any issues that she'd had in the past that were going to rear their head while we're away. And a lot of it was preventative medicine. So we made sure that all of the crew had their own little alcohol gel bottles, because the last thing we wanted to do was transfer any infection to Shu whilst we were making up her drink. So we'd make sure that we were quite stringent about that. And certainly prior to the race, it was we did some crew training with regards to CPR, if I wasn't in the follow call, if she was to become injured and have a cardiac arrest. And you know, she fell off and she was unconscious, how to manage an airway, how to manage simple first aid. But I guess my main concerns going into this race were about the climatic conditions, and that is the altitude, the heat illness, and how that impinges on her being dehydrated and the potential for hyponatremia. And the sleep deprivation or restriction is a main thing, because that actually would give me a lot more work. If she fell asleep on the bike, I'm going to get more work to do. So, you know, the whole plan was for me not to do any work at all, and be very much preventative. So,
okay. Yeah. Fantastic. No, that gives some great insight. Is there anything, are there any really interesting scenario plans that you wade through before the event?
There were tons, yeah. So I think we probably covered pretty much every scenario, or at least we think that, and I think reflectively, we think we covered everything that we thought we could think of. And it was things like, if you went to use the bathroom in the bushes, then what happens if you were bitten by an animal, like a snake?
Okay.
Or the fact that you were riding in dusk for a lot of the time, and the constant, you know, if you were getting mosquito bites and how they would become irritated. It's a lot about, if you're riding for 22 hours a day on a bike, how does your body adjust to that? You're going to get muscle fatigue, you're going to get joint swelling, you're going to get saddle soreness and discomfort, and how do we prevent doing that? So some of the things we talked about that would pretty much end the race, and that would be a decision to end the race, would be lower limb fractures.
Okay.
And upper limb fractures, we would see how it goes.
Okay. Okay. And obviously that scenario planning around upper limb fractures, very relevant as you progress through the race, and we'll talk about that more, but as we know, Shu didn't complete the race in the end, but got a long way through. So we'll touch on that shortly. But No, fantastic insight, and obviously every detail touched on there. So, Shu, I guess on the flip side of that, logistics around just getting to the US, yourself, your equipment, your nutrition, your entire support crew, tell us what that was like and how challenging that was.
Yeah, this has been a bit of a two-year project for me since I qualified, so I'm used to doing races where I am self-supported, for one thing, so it's all under my control. This time I realised that I had to have a team of up to 9 people following me around in 3 vehicles across a whole continent. You can imagine the logistics there, but not just that. After Race Around Ireland, I came away with a list of about 17 different areas I needed to focus on, of which nutrition and medical were one and two. But you know, you said comms, bikes, kit, how I would deal with electronics, that was going to work, how we're going to do rotations of crew and equipment. There's so many different things to think of. It's a lot of people say Race Across America is not about the cycling, and I'm inclined to agree with that.
Okay.
There is a huge amount of other stuff that goes on.
Really interesting. Really interesting. Okay, so we'll focus on now the race itself. Mm-hmm. So what happened during the race? Mm-hmm. You've got yourself there. You've got all your equipment through US Customs. You've got the entire crew, on deck, ready to go. How did it finally feel when you hit the start line?
You know, I think it was so exciting. We got there a few days before, and there was a lot of setup. There's a lot of things we have to do, sorting out the vehicles and getting those ready with all the numbers and fitting them out with boxes of kit and labeling everything, and having walkthroughs with all the crew and working out different routines and how we're going to do stuff. And when we finally got to the start line, there's such a buzz at the start line. It's a real atmosphere of everybody. Just the nervous tension of everybody waiting for this race. And we were actually first off in the solo race. So that was exciting. You get the big fanfare, the national anthem, and then the countdown, and then I was off. And then it's this weird first 40K where you're not supported by your crew. They're not allowed to follow you out of Oceanside. So there's this not quite the separation of me going off and cycling and not quite sure, are they going to be there in 40K? And the excitement of seeing your crew and then knowing, right, you're in a race now. This is it. We're all working together to get across the country.
I guess leading on from that there's that unsupported period early in the race, but very much support and thinking about what we said earlier about the amount of time spent on the bike. Mm-hmm. There's obviously a pit stop where you do get off the bike. Mm-hmm. And just wanted to get some insight into what those pit stops actually looked like. Mm-hmm. Maybe insight from all of you, if we could. And what did you actually do during them? So, Shu, maybe start with you.
Well, we had an idea of different types of pit stops. So, very, very quick, just an exchange of a food or drink, which we tried to do on the move where possible, getting the crew lined up with bottles and I'd take them from their hands. Maybe a shorter one where I'd just get a change of kit or grab a bit of food. Up to longer stops where we'd have a number of activities that we'd have to do, which might have medical attention or maybe some physio attention. Particularly key for me was I suffer from something called hot foot, where you get a pressure on the ball of your foot from cycling, putting your foot onto the pedal. So I do a lot of standing in ice buckets, trying to cool my feet down. It's not actually having hot feet, it's where your feet swell and they trap the nerves in your feet and you get a very weird sensation. A lot of ultra cyclists get this complaint. What else would we do at stops? Maybe you guys want to talk about some of the medical things that we did.
So before we'd actually set off on the race, we did some baseline observations with regards to Shu's resting heart rate, what her oxygen saturation was at the altitude we were at that moment. Her respiratory rate, a couple of things about her temperature, the external temperature, what the humidity was, because we know how that can affect her ability to cope with heat, and we knew that as soon as we descended into the glass elevator that we were going to hit the heat.
Sure.
So in the pit stops, it was basically just a repeat of those observations and the external temperature, the humidity, and noting the altitude, really. And that's just to give me a baseline and monitor a change in how she is. And you know, I'd said to Shu at the beginning about just tell me if there's anything that you're feeling, if there's anything odd or you're not sure about something or you don't feel 100%. And we used a bit of a grading scale just to see how she was in terms of percentages and see how that went, really. But you know, that we did that when she was eating her food. So as soon as the pit stops came in, everyone just kind of descended on her.
So very, very busy time. Matt, what about your role during those events?
So the pit stops, I mean, as you said, it's a time trial, so you want to spend as little time off the bike as possible. So when we were devising, I mean, from our point of view, the research, it was important that we wanted to capture as much data to inform others and to inform Shu if she's going to do future events like this, but also that we didn't eat into her time off the bike. So anything we did, we had to minimise the time strain on there. So when we collected saliva, when we collected the cognition, when we did and whatever the assessments and whatever markers we were looking at when we were out there, it had to be very, very short and very quick in which we were doing it.
Fantastic, fantastic. So just changing tack slightly, we've talked earlier about the challenges, and you, Shu, you mentioned the extreme weather, particularly in relation to the heat in the early part of the race as you travel through the desert. How did you actually cope with that heat? And what strategies, I'll ask these guys afterwards, what strategies were in place to really support you through that?
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, it's something I knew about. I knew that it was going to be hot in the desert. I'd actually done a training ride out in India to try and to get used to a bit of the heat, because you just don't experience that here in this country. Sure. So we trialled some of the hydration strategies out in India. Actually, in the race, as Erica said, there's a descent called the glass elevator. And you descend into the desert, and you can literally see the haze of the heat coming off the ground. One of my crew described it as descending into a hot wok. Right. It's a very technical descent down into the desert, and with crosswinds, and the heat hits you. And then you're in that desert scenario for probably just over a day, constantly. And actually, surprisingly, I didn't realize it was hot elsewhere across the race. There was a big section across Kansas and Missouri where we were still hitting temperatures of 40 degrees, which was a bit of a surprise to me. I personally couldn't feel whether I was getting hotter or colder. I mean, you're obviously aware that you're cycling in extreme heat.
Yeah.
These guys were, you know, absolutely key in monitoring my temperature across those sections. Matt made me swallow a really big pill about this big, which once inside me, he could remotely monitor my core temperature, which I have to say gave us such an advantage, because whatever I was feeling, these guys had, you know, true science behind what I was feeling to actually say, no, it's okay, you can carry on, you're not too hot, or guys, we need to get Shu in and cool her down a bit.
Okay. Matt, can you give us a little bit of information about that?
Yeah, so I mean, as you can see from the graph, this is actually 24 hours of data from Shu when she was actually, I think it was day three. So in the heat of the day, temperatures were hitting over 45 degrees at this point. But when we did some tests with Shu in the lab before she went out there, we pushed her pretty much to the maximal in 38 degrees in our enviro chamber. And her core temperature only kind of hit the mid to low 39s. Okay. So we know, or generally, critical core temperature is around about 40 degrees. So it's really important that if we knew what Shu's core temperature was when she was out there, that we were able to either put an intervention in if it got too high, or we just didn't want her to kind of creep above that 39, 39 and a half degree core temperature. So by having this remote monitoring of Shu's temperature is really a really key asset for us, because even if Shu was complaining of being hot or whatever the symptoms may be, we were able to know exactly what she was going on. As you can see from the graph, it was really interesting that Shu was had a real good affinity and was really efficient at monitoring heat and coping with the heat. Yeah. Some people would see a much larger fluctuation between nighttime when temperatures were around about 10 degrees to heat of the day at midday when temperatures were hitting 40, 45 degrees. And as you can see, so from when sunrise, Shu's temperature slowly increased to around about the mid-38s, and there was a trend to keep going up. But at that point, we kind of started to put in more interventions about how we could cool Shu. Okay. So we saw the trend of her temperature going up. So we acted immediately. So we started to put ice in her helmet, ice in her back, cooling drinks. Every time she got off the bike, we used to put her feet in a bucket. Also, at one point, we found, was it Congress? Where we found a nice pool and we hosed her down with a bit of a hose. So we tried every intervention we could do to keep her cool. And by doing that, they kind of, as she said, gave us a bit of a competitive advantage, because we could keep that exercise intensity throughout.
And Erica and Matt sort of touched on it there, but medically, did you see any major issues with Shu or indeed with any of the other riders as a result of that heat?
With Shu, thankfully not. You know, the lab tests show that she copes really well with the heat, and that was very reassuring for me as a clinician supporting her on the ride, because as Matt said, you know, a lot of it is preventative, and it's easier to treat and be prevented rather than to treat her when she's got exertional heat stroke, which would effectively, you know, it's a life-threatening condition.
Absolutely.
And it means that she wouldn't finish. So it was actually one of the time stations in Arizona that one of the other riders had come in and was disorientated and confused, and he'd actually vomited down his arm on the way in, and he proceeded to have a fit. So my thinking is either he's got exertional heat stroke or he's hyponatremic, and whichever condition, it's, you know, it's potentially life-threatening. So our treatment for him was just to cool him down as quickly as possible. I don't know if he's hyponatremic until he's had a blood test, but the likelihood is that he was. And actually, we spoke to him afterwards, a couple of days afterwards, and he'd spent 4 days in the intensive care unit being hyponatremic. He'd actually lost about 5 kilos in weight in the first couple of days. It's day two that we're in, so just before Matt's graph. And you know, the temperatures are 45 degrees, and if you're not adequately replacing your fluid, you're not monitoring your hydration status, you're not assessing your electrolyte imbalances, then you're pretty much on the hiding to losing, really.
Okay. That's a great lead into my next question, and I guess to Shu, firstly to you. Your hydration strategy was obviously a critical part and of the thinking pre-race. What was the strategy? Was it a drink-to-thirst approach or something more aggressive?
Traditionally, through my training, I've been really bad at drinking. I've been known to go out on long rides with just one bottle, which is fine on a training ride. You can come back and you can replace your fluids and you recover pretty much. It became very apparent that I couldn't do that in something the length of Race Across America. So mentally, I had to get around this idea of how much I had to drink in order to replace my fluids. So maybe we should say that it was we had an idea of how much we should be drinking per hour, and the strategy was more of a coercive strategy on the part of the crew to make sure that I kept to that. There was lots of communication over the radio, like, Shu, could you finish that drink, please?
Okay.
Or, you know, we've got another drink waiting for you. It's your favourite, if you finish that one. So, yeah, lots of persuasion, really.
Any insight from you in terms of the hydration?
Well, yeah, so, I mean, as you said, our strategy was to be quite aggressive, yep. And I guess Shu was saying it quite politely, but I say nagging. we basically spent, you know, 9 days nagging Shu to drink, really. That was kind of the premises. So during the heat of the day, when we did testing, we kind of knew that her sweat rate was around about 1.3, 1.5 litres an hour.
Yep.
So that's kind of what we're trying to aim to replace, so up to 25 litres a day. During night, it was slightly lower, so we're in cooler temperatures. So our strategy was more aggressive during the day to replace the fluid. However, kind of come day five, Shu was kind of slightly complaining of peeing quite a lot. When we say quite a lot, 5 times in 24 hours, but that's time off the bike. So I kind of decided, right, so when I was in the follow vehicle to experiment with that, to do drink to thirst. So for the 6 hours, we didn't necessarily nag or remind Shu to drink as much as possible. And when she came off the bike, that is the one time where she was actually quite dehydrated. Most of the times we were doing pee osmo checks every single urine sample, and her osmos were never higher than 5, 550. But at this point, it was 960.
Okay.
So at that point, we knew that drink to thirst was not a strategy for such an ultra-endurance challenge, mainly due to the progressive dehydration that you suffer from there.
Yeah, absolutely. So, yeah, an aggressive approach continued, no doubt.
Yeah, straight back on the aggressive. Yeah, that was a longer stop, so we managed to get rehydrate you before you got back on the bike during that longer stop.
Okay, fantastic. Anything else, Erica?
No, I guess it's just the reassurance of having the osmo checks. It's a great bit of kit, and actually, you know, we really did have to persuade Shu to drink.
Right.
She never wants to drink on the uphill. She doesn't want to drink on the downhill because she doesn't like taking her hands off. So it's very much, as soon as you hit a flat patch, it's like, have you finished that drink yet?
Okay.
Yeah, we've got 10 minutes till we finish in this drink. And then we're going to switch to another one.
We did experiment with different ways of getting drink in me as well.
Yeah.
We did put bottles in places. We tried the camelback approach as well.
I think for riders taking on this challenge, do not underestimate this practice, because actually forcing that amount of liquid inside you is not natural.
Okay.
And it is something you need to try.
Okay. Shu, you've touched on something really interesting there, and it leads into my next question. Obviously, we've talked about how much planning went into nutrition pre-event, and you mentioned how beneficial that was for this race compared to other races where you haven't been so so prepared or had so much planning, such as the Island race. With that planning, I just wanted to understand, based on what you've just said, how much adaptation on the fly had to go on, or were you able to maintain that prescribed approach throughout?
I kind of think we planned a lot of different scenarios, and we planned different crew rotations, and we planned different timings. You have to be adaptable. It just wouldn't work if you had a crew who were very set in their ways of, we're going to do it this way. And I think that's one of the great things about our crew, was everybody was adaptable and could put in put forward an opinion, and then we had a crew chief who would who'd come to a decision of how we were going to do something. And I think that worked really well, and the guys were able to be flexible and change the plan as we needed to.
Okay.
And you can't predict what's going to happen.
No.
And there's so many variables in Race Across America. You can plan as much as you want for all the things you can do something about, but there's lots that you can't do anything about.
Yeah. So if we move on, we've talked a lot about heat and hydration. What about altitude? If we just quickly touch on that, how did Shu manage during the altitude?
Well, Shu's been to altitude before. You know, she's travelled an awful lot. And so the last time, she's been affected by altitude before, but it was 4,200. So we kind of knew what we were getting into in terms of her being susceptible to it. But the fact that we were going to 3,300 metres, it's still quite a high altitude. So we knew that we could have some problems. So in that briefing before the race and in the medical training to the rest of the crew, I'd brief the crew on what to expect in terms of, with her being breathless, having a cough, all the symptoms that you would get with acute mountain sickness. And really just to be really vigilant about it. The issue for me is that the heat illness, the altitude sickness, sleep deprivation, the headaches and the nausea you start to get at the beginning, they cross over in each condition. So it was very much the crew watching Shu, and for Shu to report back any issues to me. The issue that we had on the ascent to Wolf Creek Pass at 3,300 was that she was quite breathless. And actually had to get off the bike to walk for a little bit.
Okay.
But other than that, there was no problem. You coped really well with it, didn't you? And that,
okay.
That was it, really. And bear in mind, we're monitoring her observations for the entire amount. So.
What's quite interesting about those observations is the crew decided at this point they'd quite like to jog alongside me on some of these high passes. So we were getting multiple feedback of how this felt. So I couldn't describe why this cycling became hard, because the hill was a normal hill, but it just was like cycling in treacle to actually get up it, and walking was just faster for me.
Right.
But I had the crew also, trying to run, and they were swapping over very quickly, going, that's quite hard work.
And just add on to what Erica said is that, she was lucky that she didn't suffer any altitude sickness. But that wasn't the case for all riders in RAAM. There was another female rider. She spent 12 hours in hospital, recovering from the effect of the altitude on her. So she actually did get back on and carried on riding after she recovered. But went on to win. But it's a major, major concern. But yeah, we're lucky with you.
Yeah. Yeah. Guys, if we can jump back to sleep deprivation, we were talking about that earlier, and Shu, I said we'd touch on this. How did that actually affect you during the race? You said you couldn't elicit it during your training, but how were you affected during the race?
Well, actually, what's really interesting is different things happened, and they weren't the things that I expected to happen. So I was, thinking I'm going to get hallucinations, and actually that wasn't a major part for me. This time, I had some really weird experiences, and they're particularly of deja vu. And having seen the same thing over and over again, and this maybe sort of day 7 or 8, I'm thinking, so quite a long way into the race, starting to get very distrustful of why the crew were making me do the same section again, slightly paranoid about what was happening and seeing the same thing over and over again,
okay.
which I had not expected at all. And it's still really thrown me.
Interesting. And Barry, is that consistent with what we normally expect to see from sleep-deprived individuals?
Very much so. As I indicated earlier, sleep deprivation is that, you know, sustained period of wakefulness that has been studied, you know, over the decades in science. And in the early stages of science, a lot of the sleep deprivation and the psychological effects, such as paranoia, illusions, and hallucinations, were happening as a consequence of mental illness and that sleep deprivation. So what happens when you become sleep deprived or severely sleep restricted? You end up having problems with information processing. So your glucose utilization in the brain is changed in different regions. So it's not just the information going in, but it's also the different areas of the brain that would normally talk to each other and exchange information are having problems. And then you also get those and that's where the feelings of paranoia, hallucinations come from. It's because of the shift in the neurochemical balance, if you like. So all the neurotransmitters in your brain, there's a different balance and they all kind of feed off each other. So when one of those is thrown out of whack, you get the problem. So the main one, I guess if we were to pick a culprit, if you like, would be adenosine. And so people might be familiar with caffeine. It is effective when you're feeling tired and when you're feeling a bit sluggish, and that's because it partially blocks the adenosine receptor in the brain. So when adenosine starts rising as part of your normal circadian rhythm, essentially, if we think about the currency of each of our cells, it's ATP. When ATP gets broken down, you have adenosine, which rises, and then you get this kind of promotion of sleepful behavior, if you like. So that's essentially what's happening. So combined with the sleep restriction, combined with the enormous physical activity that she was undertaking, which is breaking down ATP, causing the uprise in adenosine, you're essentially just getting everything to tell your body to shut down and to rest and to recover. But as we've heard numerous times now, all anyone in the Race Across America wants to do is stay on the bike and keep riding.
Right. And we'll talk about in a moment what the ultimate effects of that sleep deprivation. Just before we do, I just wanted to ask the crew quickly, where thinking about the support, we talked about the pit stops, just wanted to get a sense of the feel within the support team throughout the event and just understand the intensity that was involved in supporting Shu through all these different challenges we've discussed.
So I think, you know, we talked about Shu being sleep restricted, but the crew were sleep restricted as well. And I think because we were so hyped at the beginning, you know, I think we'd worked out that we'd got probably all about 8 hours sleep in the first 3 days and we were practically running on empty. So it's really important if crews are going to try this to support their rider in a better way than we did, because we needed to be having more sleep than we did to enable to fully support Shu. And I'm not sure that you saw that at the beginning. I think that kind of days, night six really is when your hallucinations really started to, or at least your anxiety and your paranoia really started to come on board. And you were in the car on that first night, weren't you? So maybe you could talk about that part.
I'll come on to that in a second, but going back to the crew, it's absolutely essential that you're rational around the rider. So what you do behind a rider doesn't matter, because Shu will never know. Your goal is to get the rider from A to B. Yeah. So what you do behind there, we were very lucky in the fact that we're a rookie crew and we all got on very well. And a sense of humour is probably the biggest thing you could ever have in the crew. If you don't have a sense of humour, you're never going to make it through RAAM. So it's really important. And being rational is such a huge part when you're communicating with Shu. And that was kind of like on day six, we realised that this is when the sleep restriction started to really take its toll. And so the learnings we got from Shu on that day six was actually, you know, had this deja vu and was kind of like distrusting us. So then after that, you know, we had a conversation, and then Erica kind of had a real rational conversation with Shu by basically saying what you're suffering from isn't true, it's irrational thoughts, we're here to support you.
And you realised that though, didn't you? On the morning of day seven, yeah, we had a very rational conversation. You could remember being irrational throughout the night. Mm. And you said, well, that's obviously going to be a good thing because I'm going to anticipate it tonight if it happens. As it happened on the seventh night and on the eighth night. And it actually just got progressively worse. So what Matt's saying about us being rational is about being direct with Shu, and there's no ambiguity about where the route is, because what she was demonstrating about the deja vu that you were having, I've been down this road before, we've done this road, why are you taking me down the same road again? So it was heightened anxiety on her part, and our job as a crew was just to relieve that and to try and coach her through that next section, which she would snap in and out of that very quickly, to the point where at 1 minute she'd be arguing with you about the route that we were taking, and the next minute she'd be perfectly normal again.
Okay.
Which I think probably threw us as a crew.
And you said this culminated towards the seventh and eighth nights. So
yeah.
I guess building to that, can you give me a feel for what happened on day nine?
Certainly day nine, I particularly remember that morning because I was really sleepy and really drowsy. And we tried lots of tactics to try and sort of keep me awake and keep active. And I think at this particular stage, it was a dawn. And I remember we were having some fun with music. And we had various tunes playing on Spotify really loudly out of the window. And we were dancing. It was dancing in the car, dancing on the bike. Got the energy levels back up again. Really high energy levels. Pulled into a time station that morning. And we were buzzing because we knew we were doing really well. We were ahead of time. Everything seemed to be going to plan. And we'd had these moments that we'd got through. And I remember this time station particularly because everybody was there. The whole crew were there, and some friends that I knew as well. And so we'd had this real atmosphere. And I don't really know what happened, but it can only be an hour after that time station where it was just hot. It was 32 degrees. The road was long and straight. And I couldn't really understand this road. And I kept looking at my Garmin showing me the route, and it was long and straight. But I kept thinking I had to turn off. And I kept turning off. And the crew were saying to me, what are you doing? And I'm like, it's a turning. And I'm looking down, it's a long straight line. Why am I turning? And this confusion of not really understanding where the end of this road was. And my eyes were starting to sort of close. I didn't feel particularly tired. I just felt slightly drowsy, you know, when you do like in a moving vehicle or a train. And I'd shut my eyes a couple of times and I'd weaved on the road a couple of times. And unfortunately, this particular occasion, even though our planned stop was literally a mile up the road, I shut my eyes, left the road, opened my eyes almost immediately, tried to right myself and pull back onto the road. What I didn't realise was that it was brand new tarmac, perfect conditions normally, except there was quite a high edge on the tarmac. And in trying to get back up onto the tarmac, I flipped the bike and fell and broke my left collarbone.
Oh, we were in a follow vehicle at that point, and we were actually in front of Shu because we leapfrogged. So I saw it in the rearview mirror. So slammed on brakes, jumped back, and Eric and I sprinted to Shu's rescue.
Leaving the car.
Yeah, leaving the car. We did
leave Zoe with the car.
Yeah, and so then and then had a bit of an assessment. You know, you kind of mentioned saw it's broken collarbone. Went to hospital, X-rays, etc. Realised the severity of it, and then that's when we kind of had this decision to make as a crew and as a rider: do we carry on? Which was hard, but in the end we had to get to this point where we realised that there was just no way Shu could keep riding. So absolutely, you know, it's impossible. We still had 800 miles to go, did 2,200. The Appalachians are climbing. It would have just been almost a death trap to keep riding. So unfortunately, we had to make that decision, didn't we? So yeah, so that was the end of it. And it was a bit of a very emotional time, wasn't it? All laying down on the grass.
Yeah, for everybody.
Yeah.
Okay, it must have been an unfortunate, really unfortunate way to finish things off. But thank you for sharing that. We're gonna move on to some questions now. I guess Shu, if I can start with you, if we could. I just wondered whether in just a few words you could sum up your key learning from the overall event and how you're going to look on the next challenge, whether it be Race Across America, what you might do differently, how you might approach it slightly differently.
I think with all of these races, you learn something different each time. I'm back to another long list of things that I can do to improve. These are just, you know, you've heard some of them. You've heard how maybe we can make some changes to the sleep strategy so that I potentially have a little bit more time to sleep so that I have less of that eye shutting. There's some investigations I want to do just there as to why did my eyes shut when I didn't feel particularly tired. ideas about the bikes. So for instance, we made some assumptions about what the route looked like and which bike I could be on at different particular times. So I mean, if I did the same race again, I'd have a huge amount of knowledge that I could actually just use there, you know, be on a time trial bike on different sections before, get a little bit of extra competitive edge of doing something faster. Around the crew, you know, these guys have stacks of improvements and things that we could change, ideas that we can work with. I mean, what I really like about this is that this is science, right? You do some experiments, you learn something, and then you take that away, and you can make some changes and make some improvements. And that, for me, is so immense. You know, if I just completed the race, would we be sat here having this discussion? Yeah, it wouldn't be as interesting, right? It would. I think that's key.
Yeah.
And I guess for Erica and Matt, learnings for you. What are some summations for you guys?
I think being able to have such a key nutritional strategy is a massive reassurance for me, because I know that she's going to be adequately fueled. So a lot of the issues around the heat exhaustion, you know, my concerns about that are lessened massively now. So if and when she attempts another race, then, you know, I won't be so worried about that. But in terms of learnings, I think it's more about what data we can pull from Shu during the race, as in, can we monitor what, you know, other factors during the race, really.
Try and predict behaviour.
There's a lot about the anxiety side of things and the sleep restriction that I'd be quite interested in.
Okay, lovely.
And how we should best manage that.
We've got some questions coming in online, quite specific, Shu, as expected, towards you. Interesting first one. How did you actually train for the event, i.e. how many miles were you completing in advance of RAAM?
This is an interesting one, because everybody thinks that there's a training plan you follow, and if anybody did it, they could just do this. Everybody's different. I've learnt my own training through a number of years and the events I've done. I do follow a fairly standard periodized training plan, so build up over a number of weeks. Fourth week, I tend to drop off my intensity and recover. I'm quite good at recovery. I generally tend to do nothing rather than low intensity on my recovery. Number of miles, I built up to Mallorca, I think was my biggest mileage, where I did about 1,200 miles in that week. Generally, on a normal week, I commute from St Albans to London, so that's 25 miles each way, direct. I tended to vary the route home and do up to 50 miles home.
Okay.
So you do that during the week and then throw in long rides at weekends. But it's self-coached. Everything's on Strava if anybody wants to follow.
Brilliant. I guess along the training lines, we've touched on your use of hydration and nutrition during the pre-events. Mm-hmm. How much of that was incorporated into your pre-race training?
A lot. You know, I come from a background of triathlon where you do not do anything on race day that you haven't practiced before. So we trialed the drinks, we trialed the strategy, trialed the food. You know, I found things that didn't work, so we tried different things. But pretty much, I don't think there was anything that we did in the race that hadn't at least been thought about before or tried before.
Sounds like a very, very sensible approach from a nutrition perspective. We've got a question coming in from another one coming in from outside, and specifically, again, nutrition related. Is there anything that you would flag as definitely I will do this differently next time round?
I would say more savoury.
Yeah.
We found that out during the course of the race, didn't we?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay.
So, I mean,
I don't know why. You can probably explain.
Yeah, savoury is an important thing. I mean, something we didn't actually touch on during was that we had a bit of acidity. So that was a main adaptation we had to do during the race. So the diet we were given was slightly too acidic. So when we had a bit of indigestion with that, we actually manipulated diet, so took fruit out, replaced it with veg, had more savoury food, and that kind of made a massive difference. So, you know, there's always going to be these manipulations in the unknown, so that would definitely be a learning that we would do. So, you know, take out less some of the sugar, put in a slightly more more complex carbs.
Okay, really interesting. You touched on that during our discussion, but that's an interesting takeout. Mm. Another interesting question. We talked about pit stops, we talked about 22 hours on the bike, but actually when it came to it, how much sleep were you actually getting during the event on a daily basis?
That's a really difficult question to answer because you can imagine how frantic this was in trying to record all this information. Mm-hmm. We're now trying to glean that information back from the data we have. Yeah. So we were all being monitored with the actigraphs, including the crew. Uh-huh. I've also got lots and lots of data of recorded the GPS output of what we were actually doing, so I can see where I stopped.
Okay.
Now I'm trying to refer back to the route book to see whether was that a sleep stop, was that a pee stop, was that... just because we wanted to take a photo at a sign, you know, those kinds of things. So we're actually trying to work out. But from my memory, I remember having some very short sleeps, but I also remember being told afterwards that actually we said we gave you 20 minutes, but we felt we needed to give you a little bit longer in certain circumstances.
So all of that data will be published at a later date, I guess. Mm. So we've got it all recorded. It's currently in analysis. But just kind of like very top line, I think the cumulative total of Shu's sleep per day will be somewhere around about the 2.5 hour mark of total sleep, of actual shut-eye time each day.
And Shu, another question for you. Did it ever get to the point where it just seemed like it was all too much and you thought, I can't do this anymore?
No. Okay. No. I think everybody would agree that wasn't...
No,
there was nothing in the race like that.
Okay.
The feeling amongst the crew was so high the entire time. Like, we knew we could do it. We knew that it was going well, that we'd thought about it, we'd planned, and we were being able to adapt to that plan. As we got to the 900 miles to go, we were so geared up for counting down each 100 miles, that there was no, this is not going to be possible.
That's probably one of the hardest things for us as a crew and as riders to accept. It's because physiologically, energy, everything was fine with Shu. She had no musculoskeletal issues. It was just purely the collarbone that went. So that was why it was harder for us and as a crew to kind of like accept. Really.
On the upside, it makes it easier to accept that I went out the reason I did, because it's a genuine reason for failing.
Yep.
You know, I could not carry on those descents of the Appalachians with one arm. Mm. However, I know people who did pull out who are suffering hugely with regret of pulling out for other reasons that may have been controllable. So for that, I feel confident that, we could have done it if I hadn't fallen off.
So it gives you a lot of confidence for next time round, should you go there again.
Were you putting words into my mouth there? it's something I'm considering.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, clearly at the moment I'm in a lot of pain from broken collarbone, which isn't fusing as well as it could do, because I have quite a lot of displacement in my collarbone. So I can't actually ride a bike at the moment.
Right.
So the idea of doing 3,000 miles, it seems quite daunting at the moment. But if I feel confident when I'm back on the bike that I can get back into my training again and weigh up that, it's a huge, huge commitment financially and time-wise to do Race Across America. So I have to know that I'm prepared to put in all of that training across the winter, thousands of miles of training in the British weather. Whether I make a decision to do it or not.
Well, we've run out of time. Thank you all for joining us on the webinar today, and thanks to all of those people who sent in questions that we were able to answer. The webinar will be displayed online in the near future at www.gskhpl.com, so please check that out. I hope you've enjoyed the webinar today, and we look forward to bringing more webinars to you from our location here in London. So thank you very much.